Hey, we're in the library filming an Ask Emily video. And this Ask Emily is really special because you guys called in and left us messages on our voicemail. So if you have a question for a future Ask Emily video, call the hotline. It's supposed to, the number will be right here. Yeah. Okay.
Hi, Emily. This is Alex Lent in Massachusetts. Are there librarians at the field? What do they do? Can we meet any of them?
Yes, the field does have a library and librarians. Our reference collection is hugely important because we have titles that can be highly specialized and very rare. Like, if you need to check out the first annual report of the U.S. Geological Survey of the Territories, Embracing Nebraska from 1867, we've got it. Embracing Nebraska. Hey, Nebraska. It's okay. Since many of our books were written way before the first commercial cameras, the illustrations in some volumes, like this German book from 1835 about the description and classification of animals from Ethiopia, are the only visual record that we have of an area's wildlife at that time. We filmed our Audubon episode in the Rare Book Room, which is basically what it sounds like, a room full of rare books, and in some instances, books that are hundreds of years old. Our librarians facilitate our curators, collections managers, and other researchers and members of the public to have access to these resources, but you can also find a lot of the materials online by searching the Biodiversity Heritage Library.
Hey, when is Emily from the Brain Scoop gonna drop a hot mixtape?
You know, I keep pitching the idea to Lin-Manuel Miranda about turning Carl Akeley's life story into a hip-hop album, but I guess he's kind of busy right now. I don't know. If that doesn't work out, I'm gonna hit up the Hamburger Helper Glove because his April 1st album was pure gold. Hashtag watch the stove. It was good.
I run a club for girls in STEM at my school, and I was wondering what your ideas were on how to respond when people ask us why our club is even necessary when we could just have a regular science club for, quote, everyone.
You know, I get this question a lot, and my answer is you'd be terribly out of touch if you walked into a room of people of all the same gender and race and thought that your job diversifying the workplace was finished. We know from a multitude of studies and surveys on the topic that the best ideas come from collaborations between people with diverse backgrounds. Whether that's because of their varied experiences, ages, genders, or race. But in order to achieve diverse work environments, we have to tackle some of the big issues preventing gender and racial minorities from participating in the first place. And the answer isn't because they aren't interested in the topic. One really great way to ensure that girls especially will maintain an interest in these fields is by having specific groups for them to take advantage of their own creativity in a positive and supportive environment. Because unfortunately, it's still all too often that girls are told they're naturally not gifted or interested in math and science, and that's, frankly, a load of garbage.
I'm super interested in the Field Museum's insect collection. Who collects the insect there? Because it sounded like Crystal Meyer went and collected. Is that somebody's job to go out and collect? Because that sounds awesome.
The cool thing about Crystal's job is that she gets to both manage the insect collection as well as contribute her own specimens to it. These days, many collection managers in natural history museums have or are working towards their PhDs, which are ultimately research degrees. This means Crystal doesn't just process loans and facilitate visitors, but that she can get grants and work with collaborators to pursue her own research too. That being said, a fair number of specimens in the insect collection were collected by amateur enthusiasts. You don't have to be a professional to take a serious interest in the invertebrate world around you. And even by collecting in your backyard, you can begin creating an important collection of insects unique to that particular area. If you take good notes and keep it orderly, perhaps someday you can donate it to a museum too.
If you had to survive a zombie apocalypse with any scientist, past or present, who would it be?
All right, here's my dream team. Carl and Delia Akeley for their perseverance and survival aptitude, botanist and author of Peter Rabbit, Beatrix Potter, because she could help us forage for mushrooms and tell us which ones were edible, and Dr. Ruth Patrick, a pioneer who laid the foundation for modern pollution controls in streams, because we'll need some fresh water. And my mom, for her medical expertise, and because I love my mom. Hi, Mom.
Have you actually ever gotten so grossed out by something that you couldn't, like, do it?
Not that I had to give up and leave, but I did adopt a few cats in February, and a few weeks later, one of them jumped in my lap, and when she turned around, I saw a tapeworm poke its head out of her butt and then crawl back into her butt. That was the most grossed out I have been in a really long time. But that being said, parasites are pretty fascinating creatures, and the Smithsonian in DC just inherited a sweet new collection of them, like 20 million of them, and I'm pretty jealous.
I'd like to know why the pronghorn antelope in Wyoming is not really an antelope.
pronghorn antelopes are actually more closely related to giraffes than they are to the bovines that we call antelopes. Pronghorns are members of the family Antilocapridae, which includes a number of extinct even-toed ungulates that were abundant in North America during the last 2.5 million years all the way until just about 12,000 years ago. Perhaps we call the North American pronghorn an antelope because it fills a similar niche that is filled by grazers who we also call antelopes, those that are related to bison, goats, and sheep. North American pronghorns aren't the only species with misleading common names. After all, the horny toad is a lizard, the bay snook is not a snook and doesn't live in a bay, and who even knows what a coonty hair streak is anyway? Sounds like a weird rash you would pick up from a dirty porta potty at a music festival. Anyway, feel free to leave your favorite misleading common name in the comments below.
Hi, I was wondering if you have plans to make any episodes about fishes. Like, there's this one group called cichlids, and I think they're super cool. There's like over 1,600 species of cichlids, and I heard that the neotropical ones are really awesome.
You know, what's funny about this message is that it sounds a lot like Caleb from the clearing and staining video that we did. He's the collection manager of fishes here. He works on cichlids. I mean, I worked down the hall from you. You could have just walked by. You didn't have to leave a message, but we'll get on your cichlids video. The Brain Scoop is made possible by the Field Museum and the Harris Family Foundation. It still has brains on it.